All right, smiley me. All right, back to Stones of the Gods. Now, this book is kind of an interesting one. It's these little archaeology findings of Tyurganat. Now, Tyurganat is Tyugga is the nickname. It's a little area there in Corsica. And it's all my findings, it's all my wonderful elaborations and invent of the words, the animals, the finding of where they are, they're located. There's a map. I try to put maps on most of the chapters, and they're circled. So it's very, very good for that, you know, for locating, like, this is where the high priest is. And this over here is where the pharaoh is, and over here is the overseer, and over here is the pharaoh's mask. Now, all of these things are in stone. All of these are in stone. So they're in stone fossil form. We also have fossils of dinosaurs. Now, none of this has really been documented. I'm the only one who's done this. There's no book out there that's saying right here is located at this spot. They are just forgotten stones. They're stones that have been forgotten. And when I say forgotten, I mean like the wind and the rain has devastated them to a degree so huge that most people are like, ugh, you know, it's just tedious to look at. It's tedious to look at those stones because they're not carved and sculpted as fresh as we want them, you know, as fresh as today's form. So to actually go back and I'm so tempted to say, just fix them, you know, fix them, make them all beautiful again. But then you know, it depends on I imagine that would be a lot of sculptors. And because right now they're kind of dreadful. They're dreadful. Some of them are dreadful. So we're looking at an antiquity site, and some of them are just genius. And you just want to take them home, and that's the problem, you know, because it's open to the human beings. They can go in there by boat, they can go in there by car. I drove there by car, you know. I drove there by car. Now, my little nausea dog, she died, and so we went there by car to cheer ourselves up. We went to the ocean, and there was a little nausea hedgehog there that looked just like her in stone form, and so I named it the little nausea god. And then later on, and then this nausea god was resting on top of a raven rook's nest, right on top of the rook. Now, because it was on the rook's nest, I'm like, well, this is hysterical, because you find out later that there's that combat between the raven. There's the combat between the nausea, you know, all through time. And so it was kind of a funny, it was a funny moment for nausea, for my little dog, because she got to trump the rook, just out of humor. And extra funny is my dog's name is Roo, so we have him being also quite a character there with, we'll call it the Rook. Now we have even though it's a bird, a large bird, we're talking about the name association, that attraction to the name association, and there's so many serpents there. There are lots of serpents, there are lots of fossils that are huge snakes. We have huge, massive caterpillars. And when I'm saying huge, massive caterpillars, I mean really massive, like head of 20 men, 10 to 20 men. Yeah, something like that, I guess. And so just the head though. And so these are just these beasts, they're so huge and so spectacularly large that they look like they're from a movie. And I'm like, well, this can't be possible. You know, at first you're like in a little bit of shock, but really they are dinosaurs. They're dinosaurs that have just turned into stones over the years. Now, There are other places in Corsica. It's not just there. There are other places where you have dinosaurs that have just died on the mountaintops, died on the very the mountains themselves. And when they died, they just leaned over and just heaved at the top edge of the mountain. And they're there, lying there dead, and they've turned to stone. So we have instances of those massive dragons that have keeled over, just right. They must have nested, I believe so. They must have nested, or just that was where they kept their house. You know, they were just up there, perched, and then they just died and just flopped out. This one looks like he's about to one of those dives down the mountain, but he didn't, because he flanked it instead when he died. You know, he flanked it. So it's kind of a very interesting when you look at how they died. Now this one, there's one in particular. It's you know, his head is bigger than the T-Rex. He's monster head. He has a shortened nose, but I called him the ocean dragon. And he does look like he had at one time after he died. He looks like he had an actual a volcano eruption right through him. So there was that he's that huge, that a little tiny volcano cinder cone went up right through him. So we're dealing with a really, really old site. When you look at it, you're like, but they're rocks. They're rocks. They're dinosaur rocks. And then I'm like, well, and then they even have human beings there. They have human beings, but they're just the heads, and they're all rocks also. So the human beings have turned into rocks. So when we're getting back to time dating, you know, when a person turns into a rock, that's a really old human being. That's a very old human being, and you know, possibly not even human, something else. So yeah, we have the instance of very, very fun Makara. Now, when I say Makara, that's the serpent of Indonesia, and it has a jowl. It's very swoozy jowl. Now, there's some very beautiful swoozy jowl serpents. And they're called Makaras, and they're listed on, if you look up images and you look up Makara, you look up there, and they're very ornamental. Not all of them have the swoozy jowl, but quite a few do. It's the only dinosaur that I found that is the very same, you know, in matching. When I go to, and I've looked at all of the others, it's the only one that I've seen that actually has that. So it's quite exciting now, but it's just there, you know, the head is just there laying on the ground, and it should be in a museum, or somehow we have to have some kind of a failsafe to protect it. We have to protect those stones. Also, I talk a lot in the book about, I don't know, it might be tough to read, but yeah, I talk about the indigenous cultures through time, and how they actually had an effect on those stones, the stones having an effect to them in their culture and what the stones meant. I mean, we're talking about zoolatry, so they're really, really practicing. They're practicing those animals as revered. They're practicing those animals as their gods. They have a giant frog. You know, you have a giant frog. Egypt also practices. So you have these giant frogs, and you have giant Gila monsters, and you have giant snakes. I mean, all of these are like beings that are absolutely worshipped. They would never, when we're looking at absolute worship, now I'm thinking, well, I mean, were they just vegetarians? I mean, it looks like they, when we look at how huge, they did have a huge nandi, the bull. Okay, so they have the huge bull, They have the, which makes sense as a revered character, so it looks like they wouldn't even want to eat the bull. They wouldn't want to eat the frogs. I believe I was trying to talk about the frogs. Now, on the island itself, they have a certain time of the year where the frogs croak, and they ribbit, and they're extremely loud, and they take over valleys, and so it could very well also be something to do with the timing of the frogs talking. Now, when we're looking at the timing of the frogs talking, we're looking at the water, what it means. When the frogs are talking, being seafarers, being people that traveled by boat, it must have meant something also. As I don't want to say a warning, but yeah, a little bit of a warning. Maybe don't go out. And, you know, when the frogs are singing, maybe that's just a time we never go out. And so all of these things build is to make them gods. You know, if you listen to the frogs, we live. Don't you get it? You listen to the frogs, we live. If you don't listen to the frogs, you forget to hear them, we die. You know, you go out to sea, you know, on the frog singing week, you could very well perish. So these types of things, you know, just bring the deity, bring the god worship and up one more. Oh my gosh, we listen to them and we live. You know, that's what it comes down to. It comes down to life and death. So so it's a very, very powerful sight. And then they have silly things. They have silly things. They have silly humans, massive human skulls, rocks. And I don't know. I don't know. Sometimes I wonder if they were just jokesters, humorous group also. You know, at some point they became extra funny, and they decided to be pagans. They decided to have all kinds of horns on their head. So they were revelers. They were pagan revelers. They were druids. So not only the Egyptian group, but yeah, the Egyptian pre-Egyptians were there. They were doing the profiles of hyena, jackal, very beautiful. And gosh, it just makes me almost want to go back and be there with them, because when they were carving these stones, when they were making these stones, it looks like their technique was just, it was like clay melt. It was like just like a beautiful clay. And it looks so easy. It looks so easy to carve these stones. So in a way, if we can really figure out how they made the sculptures, that would be incredible. It looks like they used lava itself. They used lava itself and they mixed it with another medium and another medium. And they made like a way to sculpt with the lava medium itself. So it was like a warm clay surfacing technique. So that's what I'm going with at the moment. So anyway, the book has over 150 animals. I think it's almost 200. A lot of photos, and I wish they were better. But you know, airhead space that I am, I was just not taking dedicated photo session. It's almost like I went there, and it's like entering the tomb of an Egyptian. It's like entering the tomb, and so when you're into the tomb, even though it's out in the open. And maybe it's done something to me. Maybe it did, you know, pulled one of those tricks. They have all kinds of, you know, you visited there. Oh my gosh, no, that's their tomb. You know, you're not supposed to go to their tomb. And yet, that's the way it goes. So anyway, it's kind of exciting. It's a kind of exciting book, and it just starts swirling your mind about the past, about zoolatry and cultures, and where they were going, and what they were doing every day. The stars, the using cosmology with their lives, with their lifestyle, just fascinating. And their love of animals. Love of animals with a reverence, and big fish, huge fish were just a major part of their lives, to where I even believe there were fish whisperers, where they used the large fish in lagoon areas to herd and lure other fish. So I believe they used the large fish as their allies. And would never kill them. So we're looking at a completely different type of people. I just love it. And yeah, a lot of there's the Mohegan chief there. So we have kind of an interesting group. Wow. Yeah.